Hare Krishna. So today we'll continue this discussion which I started yesterday on the search for a meaningful life. In the first session I talked about science and spirituality. How many of you were not there yesterday? Anybody?
Okay,
very few. Okay, thank you. So in the first session I talked about how all our human life is basically a search for meaning. We have chaos, order, and we have chaos, and we try to bring order so that we can function meaningfully. But why should there be anything orderly or meaningful in the world? That is not very easily explainable with an atheistic worldview. We discussed that there can be either no meaning or some meaning or ultimate meaning. So if somebody gives a message that is something which is written as a message, and if it is completely random squiggles, just graffiti, okay, just some hazy pattern. But if it all is as per a script and everything is letters and words, but they don't mean anything, that also doesn't make sense. If somebody has written precisely words and letters, then there should be some meaning in it. So life, is it meaningless or meaningful? We intuitively live as if our life is meaningful. We try to make responsible choices. So what explains that meaning? Could it be that there is, within a materialistic worldview, we have a very small frame that death is the ultimate destroyer of meaning. And we work hard to earn money, to gain position, to gain knowledge, and suddenly everything can end at one moment. So to make sense of that, in the second session, I talked about how there are different religions, and at one level, some are exclusivist, some are pluralist. This is the only way, or all ways are right. And there's inclusivism, which is one purpose which includes many ways, like going from the bottom of the mountain to top of the mountain. And then I discussed the test acronym. Does anyone remember TEST? T was?
Time honored.
E was?
Explanatory.
S? Scriptural. And T was last?
Transformational.
So we can see which are the, whatever path we are trying to follow, considering following, whether it has these characteristics as a way to decide whether it is a path worth following. So you want to be open-minded but not empty-minded. The minds have to be open to that, some knowledge can come in, some understanding can come, but then minds are like mouths, they have to close. So then when we are trying to look at a worldview which can make sense, I talked about how we could have two extremes, Judaism, the Abrahamic religions, they accept soul but not reincarnation. Buddhism accepts reincarnation but not soul. Then in the third session I talked about how when we are looking for meaning, if we move forward with the understanding of soul and reincarnation both, then we can make sense of what is happening in our life. I took the example of a cricket match. If the starting scores are different, why are the starting scores different? Either the scores come randomly, or the scorekeeper is biased, or it's a second innings, it's a multiple inning match. So reincarnation expands our causal framework, our causal box in which you can put things. So intelligence means we need to know in which causal box do we put a particular situation. Then I talked about destiny. Does anyone remember the 4D equation? Yeah.
Duty plus destiny plus duration equal to desire.
Yes, excellent. Thank you. So what we do, what is not in our control, and then the time duration, I discussed elaborately how the percentage may vary. Sometimes our duty might just be one part, and by destiny we are going to be in a certain situation no matter how much we change. But sometimes our part might be 99% and destiny might appear to be invisible. So in the normal situation, we eat food and we get energy. So you might think there's no role of destiny. Eating food is producing the energy. But if somebody has poor digestion and they eat food, they don't get energy. So that intermediate gap between our action and its result, that sometimes may be apparent to us, sometimes it may not be apparent. But that gap is what actually is destiny, where destiny fills in. So today we have several questions which we'll be discussing in the next session, but today I'll focus on one thing that can we be destined to ruin ourselves? What I mean is, can we be destined to commit mistakes? Can we be destined to be evil? Can we be destined to be self-destructive? So when I talk about this equation, duty plus desire, destiny plus duration leads to, now how free are we to do our duty? Sometimes it appears as if we are just pushed to do something. And this we see, for example, when somebody becomes addicted, then it's almost as if they have lost their free will. No matter how much they strive, they are not able to act. So broadly, just wipe this. There are different theories of human nature. One theory is that people are intrinsically good. That basically people are good, but somehow upbringing, situations and other people around them may make them bad. And other theory is people are intrinsically bad. So now let's look at this. Say for example, there are some people who are terrorists, and like I told yesterday about, you know, how in the Nazi concentration camps they would make people work and work and work and give no result at the end. So tragedy is where just bad things happen, but evil is where bad things are deliberately done by someone. So say if we consider the Mahabharata, the Pandava's father, Pandu, dying when they were very young is tragedy. Dhritarashtra being born blind, at least from this life's perspective, we could say is tragedy. But Duryodhan's trying to poison Bhima, is that tragedy? That is what? That's evil. So now, are some people just intrinsically bad people? Now we would normally want to believe that people are basically good. How many of you think that people are basically good? Okay. How many of you think that people are basically bad? Okay, I mean, soften, nobody would accept that. I'll soften the question. How many of you think that some people are basically bad? And we can say that some people doesn't include me. Is it? So it's so much easier that some people we do see such malevolence, such brutality that some people do. And you can maybe can see it in movies when there are villainous characters. No, they deliberately cause harm to others. So now in the politics today, have you heard of these two words, left and right? So what is your understanding of left and right? Say some people are leftist or some people are right wing or left wing. So what does it mean? Yes?
Like left wing means it is more toward communist type of government, and right wing is more toward capitalist type of government.
Okay, is that all? Because if you see, religious extremists are called what? Right wing. So is religion and capitalism the same thing? You're right, on the right track. Good answer. The first part is definitely right, that left wing is communism. Any other answers about left wing? You have heard these words? How many of you have never heard the word left wing and right wing? Never heard? Oh really? Okay. So say in the news sometimes, actually I was in the West right now, America, UK, Canada. So when the current government, BJP won, all the Western newspapers are saying that, oh, this extremist right-wing government has won. That's the way they try to put it. Okay. Anyway, it doesn't matter if you don't know. I'll just put it very simply. See, basically, that every situation for doing anything constructive, you need a hierarchy. Say, for example, hierarchy means if you have to, if you are told, okay, can you, we have to build, we have to make the surrounding ground into a garden. Now, all of you have to work as a team. Maybe there's a big ground and maybe 50, 30, 40, 50 of you have to work together. But if all of you have to do gardening, you'll intrinsically find out that some of you are better than others at gardening. And it is advisable that those who know more about gardening than others, let them take the leading positions. You know, okay, you know what to do, so you do it and you guide others. Okay, you know, don't, you can dig over here, put water over here, get this kind of crops over here, you know, could do whatever. So any work that has to be accomplished by nature or by culture, I mean here by upbringing, training, somebody's lived in a, maybe a rural place where they have been in irrigation, they have been in cultivation, they might know more. Or somebody has lived in a home where they had done some gardening, they might know more. So if something simple as gardening is to be done, then there will be a natural hierarchy that is formed. Those people who know more, they can be, we can say they will be at the top of the hierarchy because they can get the job done better. And so they will guide, and of course they should also work, but they, their time, their energy, their intelligence is best utilized in making sure that others' energy is properly utilized. So a hierarchy is formed based on, here you could say, ability or knowledge, the capacity to make the work productive. But whenever a hierarchy is formed, it's always possible that those who are at the top of the hierarchy, so now it's very hot today outside, so those who are at the top of the hierarchy, they may say that, you know, okay, you do this, and they may go and sit in the AC room. So those who are at the top of the hierarchy might just use that privilege to be comfortable and make others do all the work. Now, if they know more than others, their being top at the top of the hierarchy is it makes sense. But their using their position to simply dominate others and not do anything themselves, that is undesirable. So the right wing thought says that hierarchies are essential, and right wing is concerned with maintaining hierarchies. Any kind of hierarchy is required. So for example, with respect to capitalism, there are people who have money, they have capital, so they have the resources, and then they can provide jobs and let others work. There will naturally be a hierarchy created. So in religion also, there will be some people who may know more about religion. Say, if you want to do any particular ritual, or if you want to do, if somebody marriage has to be done, now somebody has to know how that marriage is to be done. So then naturally, that priest who knows it, that person goes at a slightly higher level. So right wing is concerned with maintaining hierarchy, and that is required for effective functioning. The left says that hierarchies are very bad because those at the top exploit others. So therefore, the left is concerned with bringing down hierarchies, or at least making sure that those at the bottom of the hierarchy are not dominated and exploited. So communism, as you rightly pointed out, is the idea that everybody is equal. But functionally, both schools of thought are required. Now, hierarchy is required, but we also have to make sure that the hierarchy does not go towards tyranny. It doesn't become exploitative. So the left will make sure that those who are at the top don't become exploitative. But the right makes sure that those who have more ability, more knowledge, more expertise, they are engaged properly so that the whole of society benefits from them. So in capitalism, the differential is wealth. In religion, the differential ideally should be purity. So whenever those who are at the top don't have qualification, then that's when the hierarchy becomes tyrannical. The hierarchy becomes exploitative. So some people are just better than others at handling money. you know, okay, I had this much money, invest in this, don't invest in this, use the money this way, don't use it that way. So if those who are good at handling money are the capitalists, then they can produce wealth for everyone. But if they are simply interested in hoarding money and exploiting others, then that's unhealthy. Similarly, in religion, if those who are pure, if they guide others, then everybody can move towards purity. But instead, those who are at the top of the hierarchy simply impose that hierarchy based on their position, their birth. I was born in the Brahmin family, so I am great. And everybody has to bow down to me. Then it will become the exploitation. That's how we had the exploitative caste system in India. So why am I talking about all this? Let's now apply this point to morality. When we talk about, are people good or are people evil? So most of you almost agreed to this point that some people seem to be bad intrinsically. So the left says that actually no one is bad. It's only situations make them bad. The right says that people are intrinsically likely to do bad things. And unless you police them constantly, they will do wrong. So the communist theory is that, say, if there are terrorists, why did they become terrorists? Oh, it was because, you know, they lived in poverty, they did not have any support, society discriminated against them, society exploited them, and that's why they became bad. Now, to some extent, this is true, but we can have two different counters to it. One is that it's not that everybody who is poor and exploited becomes a terrorist. Second is that many people who are terrorists are not necessarily poor, uneducated, exploitable. Some of the terrorists are very well educated. In fact, many of the leaders of the extremist or Taliban or IS or all of them, you know, they are educated. They are what in India we call foreign educated. They have degrees from you. Recently there's a bombing in Sri Lanka. And almost all the conspirators in that bombing had degrees from Europe, main conspirators. So something seems to be going. I'm using terrorists simply as an example over here. So the point is that, are people innately good or innately bad? So the left says everybody is innately good. So the left says everybody is innately good, situations make them bad. Whereas the right says people are innately bad. And like and they need to be policed, they need to be controlled. And yesterday I talked about Christianity and its idea of original sin as a genetic defect. Because Adam sinned originally, and all of humanity is a descendant of Adam. So therefore, we are all sinful. And unless we are saved by God's grace, by Jesus' grace, we won't be saved. So now, between these two theories of nature, that people are innately good and people are innately bad, the bhakti wisdom of India offers us a balance. Basically, how does it offer balance? By telling us that there are two levels of innateness. If we consider a person, in a person, there's the body, there's the mind, and there's the soul. So what it says is, now the body and the physical is what we see in front of. Now you are looking at my body, I am looking at your body. Now what it explains is that the soul, to put it here, has the potential for good. The soul is godly because it is a part of God. So at that fundamental level, everybody is potentially good. But the mind has a propensity for vice, for bad. So you could use, so the mind is contaminated. And the mind has a propensity for vice. So now, depending on how strong is this propensity for vice within the mind, people may by default gravitate towards good or gravitate towards bad. Because everybody has a mind, And this mind is like, if you want to compare an example to this, this is a body like the hardware, the mind is like the software, the soul is the user. So now, each one of us, our software is programmed in a particular way. But now this programming is not just from our situations. Some of this programming comes from our previous lives also. So this, now this programming, where all does it come from? You could see there are three main factors. There's past life, we can say upbringing or parenting, and then there is association or situation. So these three factors shape the kind of impressions that are there within us. So if you have an interaction with small babies, all babies cry, but some babies cry in a way that they're going to bring the whole house down. Their crying is not crying, it's screaming. So it's like those babies, even when they are in their crib, it seems they're looking out of the crib and thinking, when am I going to take over the house? So, and any parent who has had 2-3 children, they, if you ask them, both the children, if they have 3 children, all 3 children have their genes. But each child is an individual. It's not that they are exactly the same. Even twins are not exactly the same. What to speak of brothers, or what to speak of siblings. So I was in Canada, I was in UK, London, and I was giving a similar talk, and there I was talking about the concept of monozygotic twins. Monozygotic twins are, you see, twins can be formed in two ways. First is that two sperms enter into the female's womb and then two eggs are formed. And the other is that one sperm enters, then while it's reproducing, it splits into two and then it grows two. So this is called a monozygotic, is when it's one sperm that has split in, one egg that has split into two. One zygote that, so then bizygotic is where there are two initially. So when when it's monozygotic, then they are not just genetically similar, they are genetically identical. And yet they are behaviorally dissimilar. So why is that? Modern science ascribes a lot of our behavior to our genes. But it's not that our genes exhaustively describe us. So beyond our genetic behavior is what we have carrying from our past life. So basically, from our past life karma, from our upbringing, and from our association. So some people say, for example, now from their upbringing itself, they might be born in a family where maybe eating meat or even eating beef or smoking or drinking, it is considered normal. It's considered normal, and they just grow up doing it. They don't even question it because nobody questions it. Or somebody might be brought up with good parents, but they get into college, and in college they have bad associations. Somebody introduces to smoking, somebody introduces to drinking, somebody introduces to drugs, and then nobody is born a drug addict. But even after a few years of use, somebody might become an addict. Few months of use also, somebody can become an addict. So now, based on the kind of impressions that are there within us, certain kind of behaviors will be more natural and certain kind of behaviors will be less natural. So now, how is all this related to our previous topic of destiny? You could say at least this part, the kind of programming we carry from our past life, that is determined by our destiny. So our past is determined the kind of impressions that are formed in our mind. See, our mind is like a program. So a program means, it's like a programmable device. It's like a software. That means whatever we do, it gets impressed in our mind. And it stays there. Say now, suppose somebody has visited a particular website repeatedly. Maybe say Bollywood.com. And therefore, they visited the website repeatedly. And they come for maybe a spiritual program like this. and then they hear about Bhagavad Gita. Say, I want to know a little bit about Bhagavad Gita. So they want to go and find out, so they Google. And they type on their browser Bhagavad Gita. So they start typing B. And what happens? Bollywood comes up immediately. Although at that time they didn't want to go to Bollywood, but what happened? Because of their past choices, this has been stored as a preference, as a preferred choice which comes up. So basically what happens, can you just actually, is this clear? Any questions about this till now? Specifically, we'll have time for questions, but is this, can I wipe this off? Can you wipe this? So, actually I could have kept some of it. Let me keep it again. Okay. I'll talk about that. I'll explain those factors. Say now, here I'll keep the same thing. So this is the body. Body, you can say everything here is the physical reality. This is the mind. So now the actions that we do, they go in as impressions. So if I do an action, the action has an outer result. Action, what I'm doing is outer, but every action will form an impression internally. Say somebody drinks once, somebody takes a drug shot once, it's an action that they're doing externally, but that action also has an internal consequence. That's an impression which is stored in the mind. And then what is the impression stored in the mind? It comes out as a proposition. And that proposition leads to the repetition of the action. So now the more the times the impression has been formed, the stronger is the proposition. And the stronger is the proposition, the repetition becomes more and more likely. So the mind is where our impressions are stored. And say for example, somebody drinks. So they drink for the first time. It said that first the drinker takes the drink. Then the drink takes the drink. That means what has happened is that proposition comes. Let's drink once again. So the previous drink that the person has taken, that prompts, let's drink again. So the impression comes as a proposition. First the drinker takes the drink. It is the drinker taking the drink, but the impression is formed. Then the drink takes the drink. And then eventually, the drink takes the drinker. that impressions become so strong that that person's life becomes almost completely controlled by them. So basically, now with this broad framework, we could say that our past life karma, we carry as impressions within us. That's why, you know, we, if somebody does something wrong, something unwanted, then we may not be punished for our wrongdoings, but we will be punished by our wrongdoings. We may not be punished for our wrongdoings means even nobody catches us. So sometimes somebody does something wrong and nobody catches them. So I'm not punished for my wrongdoing. Somebody may take some drug and nobody can catch them. Oh, I got away with that, I enjoyed it. We may not be punished for our wrongdoing, but we will be punished by our wrongdoing. What is the punishment? How are we punished by our wrongdoing? That wrongdoing will gain control over us as an impression, and that will make us to do that wrong again and again and again. And that's how our free will, our capacity to exercise our free will decrease more and more and more. Yesterday I quoted Oscar Wilde, you remember, about smoking? So giving up smoking is the easiest thing in the world. What did I have? I have done it over 100 times. So what has happened? That means he may decide in the moment of elimination, I want to give it up. But then when the impression comes, it's very difficult to say no. So we all have a mind that is very impressionable. And because the mind is impressionable, we have to be very cautious about what kind of impressions we put into it. And for the mind, all the senses are pathways by which impressions come in. See, normally we will be cautious about taking any physical substance into our body. Say if somebody offers us, if we are never drunk, if our parents had taught us don't drink, then if somebody offers a drink, something physically going into our body, we'll be cautious. Should I take it? Should I not take it? Somebody offers a drug, it's again going into our body. Hey, take an injection. No. So we are cautious about taking any substance into our body. Even if somebody offers us some food, who has cooked it? Where is it brought from? We'll check. We don't want any foreign objects to go into our body. But from the mind's perspective, from which sense the input is going, it doesn't matter. That means, even with my eyes, if I see something, then for the mind, for the impressions to be formed in the mind, whether something goes in through the mouth or through the skin or through the eyes, the impressions get formed that way. That's why there can be different kinds of behavioral compulsions, addictions. Nowadays, with so much visual temptation available for us all around us, it's very easy to get hooked. And because when this visual temptation, there doesn't seem to be any physical substance in which we are indulging in. So you say, okay, there's no harm. But as far as the impressions that are being formed in the mind, there is definitely harm in it. Maybe we'll discuss this later, but I don't want to go into specific behavioral issues. We are discussing a bigger picture over here. That is, are some people destined to be bad? So what we could say is that some people can be destined towards wrongdoing from their past. So Duryodhan, some people say that, see, there is some kind of temptation within many modern Indians to try to present the Ramayana and the Mahabharata, which are very popular epics, to give some new twist to them. So I was in a class in South India. As I spoke on Ramayana, after that one person came and he told me that I belong to the RPC. I said, what is the RPC? That is the Ravana Protection Committee. I said, what do you do? He said, actually, it's crazy. I said, actually, Ram was a North Indian. Ravana was a South Indian. And these North Indians have spoiled the good name of the South Indians and they have misrepresented Ravan. Ravan was such a good person that although Sita was with him all the time, he did not violate her. So his good name has been spoiled and we are going to protect his good name. Now, it was not because Ravan respected Sita's consent so much that he did not violate her. If he was going to respect Sita's consent, then why abduct her in the first place? Isn't it? He did not violate her because he was cursed that if he violates any woman, then he will die. So basically, people try to tell different kinds of stories. Oh, this happened to him in his childhood, that happened to him in his childhood. And because of that, he was bad. Otherwise, he was a good person. So similarly, about Duryodhan, people say that actually it was Shakuni who spoiled Duryodhan. Duryodhan was a good person. Now, yes, Shakuni was a schemester. He came up with conspiratorial plans. But Duryodhan had that innate tendency toward evil. The first conspiracy was where he tried to poison Bhima. And that was, he alone did it. Shakuni was not in the picture at that time. And he was just a teenager at that time. For a teenager to make the whole plan to conspire and to kill, that's not a simple thing to do. There has to be a lot of tendency toward evil. So there is, can you wipe this? There is a difference between weakness and wickedness. Weakness and wickedness. See, weakness is hot-headed. Say sometimes somebody gets angry and just yells at someone, or sometimes somebody gets angry and suddenly hits someone, slaps someone, beats someone. Now physical violence is not good. Anger, even if there is anger needs to be controlled. But that at one moment somebody feels angry and does something wrong, that is weakness. But wickedness is somebody who in a cold-blooded way plans. this is where I'll catch this person. This is where I'll, if I do this, then I can hurt this person in the most possible way. I can hurt them the most and nobody will catch me for it. So, weakness is hot-headed. Wickedness is cold-blooded. So, weakness is something which we all have. All of us have anger within us, we have lust within us, we have greed within us. And we are all dealing with that. But wickedness is where there is, it's not just one moment that some temptation comes and we fall for it. Rather, we plan in a very systematic, diabolical way to indulge in something. So, when we see wicked people, say for example, somebody who's a terrorist who becomes a suicide bomber. Somebody takes a gun and shoots innocent people. It's not just one moment they get angry and they do it. It's like they have thought about it, planned about it, and in a cold-blooded way they try to attack in a way that they can hurt the most people when they are the most defenseless. So that's not weakness, that's wickedness. So now where is the difference? If we consider, I talked about this at the level of the soul, there is this potential for good. And at the level of the mind, there is the propensity for bad. So, the essential human struggle for everyone is this potential for good has to fight against the propensity for vice and come out. It is not that automatically, if everything is, all situations are made nice for us, we will all behave nicely. There will be an inner struggle. The magnitude of the inner struggle will vary depending on how strong is the propensity for wrongdoing, the bad impressions within us. How strong is the propensity, that much we may have to fight. So yes, it's true that people are innately good. But that doesn't mean that if you just provide everything for them, people will automatically behave nicely. It doesn't necessarily work like that. So that the people have to be empowered so that their potential for good, that their spirituality can overcome their conditioning. So the conditionings are stored in the mind, and that's essential spirituality is the level of the soul. So each one of us needs to be empowered to bring out our core spirituality. Now before I was introduced to Krishna consciousness, when I was in college, I was studying my engineering. At that time, I had a lot of faith in the power of education. So, in my engineering college, I joined a social welfare organization. And I decided that organization had many different wings. So, I decided to help in education. So, we would go to, as a part of a team, where we would go to the nearby slums. And I would offer few free tuition classes to the slum children. To teach English, history, maths. And I started talking with, when I was teaching, we became friends. And then they opened up about their life. And soon I found out that their homes were dysfunctional. Mostly there was domestic violence. The father was often an alcoholic. And now if I had a stereotype of an alcoholic as a person who, you know, he drinks and just falls on the road and is helpless. No, I found that these alcoholic, this father, they're nice people. And whenever they would be there at home and I would go to their locality for giving classes, they would thank me. Thank you for coming and doing these classes. But then these kids would tell me that once they take alcohol, then they become like a different person. Become like a completely different person. So basically what happens is, alcohol is one of the things which unleashes our lower propensities. We all have certain inhibitions. Now those inhibitions can sometimes stop us from doing good, but many times they stop us from doing bad also. Say, if we are very angry with someone, still we may not verbally abuse them. But if you take alcohol, then the inhibitors to civilized behavior are removed by that. And then we do things which we would normally not do. So basically, So then we thought of going into helping people get over alcoholism. So we learn some things, we talk with the, we organize some seminars for those parents, the fathers, and a good number of them started giving up alcohol. And one of my friends used to go to a nearby village, and he managed to give up. He managed to make the whole village, you could say, what is it, sober. That give up, everybody gave up alcohol. It's a very small village, but it is a big success for us. But then one day, this friend came back from that village, and he looked shattered. And he told me that there had been local elections had been there, and one of the political candidates, in order to win, he had brought like 2 truckloads of alcohol free for all those who would vote for him. And not only the fathers, but even their kids had drunk. So, you know, that was a big, big setback for us, and that made me start thinking. So till then, I also had this idea that, you know, people are innately good. You know, these people are poor because there are no opportunities for them in their lives. If you provide them education, education will open new doors for them. And once those new doors open, they can create a better life for themselves. Now, it's true. Definitely, somebody is educated. They can have chances for better job. They can have chance for a better life as compared to when they're uneducated. But then it struck me that things are not that simple. There is something inside us which works against us. And in my college, I was always among the good students, and I was always in the good crowd. I was not really mixing with people who were into alcohol or drugs or even smoking. But then I could see there are students who were declining that way also. There was one student who was, I studied in electronics and telecom, and this boy was a genius in that. So in our 8 semesters, he was always not just a college topper but the university topper. Brilliant at electronics. But then he was also a chain smoker. And when I would meet him and talk with him, he would say that actually this helps me to think. I can think sharper when I smoke. But then I used to, but you know, how long? It might help you to think sharper right now, but this is going to burn you inside. You know, when somebody has said that at one end of the cigarette is fire, at the other end is a fool. So, so then this boy, he got the highest paying job in the history of our college at that time because he was so good. There's a sensation. Within the first 6 months of his doing that job, he was diagnosed with lung cancer. And within a year or so, he succumbed to it. It was a very advanced lung cancer. So then it struck me that it is not just people who are uneducated. It is even people who are super brilliant. So this presence of something within us that works against us, it struck me very powerfully. And that's when I started trying to understand our inner world. Try to understand what goes on inside us and how that can be, how we can internally empower ourselves, not disempower ourselves. That's when I read the Bhagavad-Gita. I had read the Bhagavad-Gita as a child, but that was more of a religious ritual. Maybe some shloka recitation competitions, I memorized some verses. But then this friend gave me a Bhagavad-Gita and I read it. And then I understood the concept of the mind in the Bhagavad-Gita. And that helped me to make sense of so many things. And when I'm saying that I saw all these, it's not that I had no bad habits. I also had my share of, I was very short-tempered. So I used to wonder, why do I get angry like this? But then slowly things started making sense to me. So if we want to make ourselves better, if we want to make our world better, it's not just enough to give people options externally. See, you could say that the left focuses primarily on social engineering. Social engineering means that you change social situation in such a way that life will become better for people. So, for example, now in India we have reservations. That is an example of social engineering. And okay, certain castes were exploited and deprived for a long time. Now they should be given an opportunity. And that's why there are certain quotas. Now in the West, there is they don't have reservations. In America, they have what is called affirmative action. Affirmative action is where, if you know American history, many Africans were brought from Africa to America by the British as slaves. And slavery was there for for a long time, and eventually Abraham Lincoln was the person who had the civil war under him, and then slavery was removed. But still some amount of racial discrimination remained. So now what has been found is, so Americans are concerned, okay, we should avoid this racial discrimination, we should try to end it. But then what they did, so overall, as the African Americans, you know, the words Negroes or Blacks are now considered, Negro is definitely considered politically incorrect, you cannot use that word. In fact, there was a professor who was fired from his tenured job just because he used that word. It's considered that politically incorrect to use that word. But anyway, so the African Americans were gradually rising till around 1960s, 1970s. But then the government decided to launch what they call a war against poverty. And what was the war against poverty? They said that anybody who is below a particular economic level, we will help them. So there are single mothers. You know, sometimes say the man and a woman may unite, and the man may not take responsibility. Man may just abandon the woman, and then the woman is left alone. How will she take care of the child? So then we will support single mothers. So they launch a series of initiatives by which they thought that we will help counter poverty. But actually, the whole thing backfired. And today, the gap between the gap in poverty levels and criminality levels between the Caucasians, that is the whites, and the African Americans, is more than in the 1970s. In many ways, it's more. What happened was, now this is not just about African Americans, but I'm talking about a universal human psychology. See, what happened was, over a period of time, the situation became such that if a woman is a part of a duly wedded family, then they have to work to take care of the children. But if a woman is a single mother, the government will provide support for them. So the incentive for forming a family, for being stable in a family, for living responsibly, that was taken away because of the social engineering. And it led to two things. It led to one thing is, men, see, in the past, see, the attraction between male and female is always there. And that can impel people to do wrong things. But at least in the past, it was that if a man makes a woman pregnant, the man takes the responsibility for the woman. But when social engineering started, okay, if the woman becomes pregnant, she's a single mother, the state will provide for them. And the man has no reason to take responsibility. And if somebody is poor, there are some countries in Europe which are welfare states. They say that if you are not able to hold a job, if you don't get a job, or if you're not qualified enough to get a job, then the state will support you. State will provide you your basic for living. And what happened was that people, they don't work, and then the state provides them, and then they use the money provided by the state to smoke, to drink, to take drugs. And it has only made things worse. So here the point I am making is that certainly those who are in trouble, it is the responsibility for others to help them. But social engineering in terms of, is social engineering without inner engineering is counterproductive. You provide people money, but what do people do with their money? Because there is an innate tendency towards evil within us, propensity, we may use it for counterproductive purposes. And the result of that is things often end up becoming worse. So, whenever we want to improve society, or for that matter, improve ourselves, improving externals is important, no doubt. And some people are in such terribly poverty-stricken situation, that they don't even know where the next meal is going to come from. But there are many people, if they are given a choice between getting a next meal and getting a next drink, they will choose a drink instead of a meal. So it's not just that you have to provide people resources for living, you also have to provide people purposes for living. What am I living for? So this is where a spiritual worldview comes in, is very important. Like I earlier talked about, life is ultimately having some meaning. If anyway one day I'm going to grow old and die, then whether I work hard and build a career or just smoke and drink and watch TV and play video games and die, what difference is going to make? So a spiritual purpose to our life gives meaning to our life. And then with that meaning, when we work, then we can work more productively, more fruitfully. So when we are practicing spiritual life, sometimes it might appear as if we are spending so much time chanting, we are spending so much time learning this philosophy. Is this going to practically benefit anyone? Actually, what it does is, practically, it is helping us to curb the propensity for wrongdoing, propensity for bad, for vice within us. And it is helping us to bring out our potential for divinity, potential for goodness. And that, by that, we can create a better life for ourselves, and we can also help others create a better life for them. So that's why inner engineering, or you could say spiritual engineering, is extremely important for social transformation. Now, it can also go to the other extreme, where people just do the rituals, but there is no transformation. That is also not desirable. If somebody does chant some mantras or does some yajnas, I had gone to a Kumbh Mela, and there was this priest, you know, with a long beard and wearing a traditional priest robes, and he was chanting these mantras and lighting a fire, and he was chanting very beautifully, quite impressive. A lot of people were watching, and then he did the yajna, and then everybody went away, and then he took out a bidi, and he used the fire from the yajna to light the bidi. So there what has happened, you know, there is no, you may have all the rituals which are meant to transform you, but the rituals are not transforming the person. What the rituals are doing is, they are being used to pander to your lower side. That is very undesirable. So if somebody has the practices that are there, they can help us to bring out our divine side, our good side, but it has to be used for that purpose. If it is just ritualistically, it will not help. So when we understand that there is multiple levels of innateness for us, that there is the mind, and beyond that there is the soul. So the mind has a propensity for wrongdoing, and how much of a propensity, that will vary from person to person based on what kind of impressions they have in their mind. But beyond that, there is a potential for divinity. So then that inner struggle to bring out our potential for divinity, that is the essential struggle for every living being. Every one of us has to go through that. For some of us it may be a bigger struggle, for some of us it may be a lesser struggle. But if we are just fighting at the level of the mind, I will not do this, I'll do this, I'll not do this, I'll do this, it will not work. Because maybe we have some good impressions within us, we have some bad impressions within us. And when the good impressions come prominent, we say, I'm going to give this up, I'm never going to do this again. And when the bad impressions come up as propositions, forget all these rules, I just want to enjoy. So that tussle will go on. So at the level of the mind, based on the strength of the impressions, in that tussle, sometimes we might win, sometimes we might lose. But if we go below the mind to the soul, and that's when we practice our spirituality in a heartfelt, dedicated way, then we will draw strength from within that we didn't even know that we had. And that spiritual strength will enable us to counter whatever negative impressions might be there within us. And that's how we can transform ourselves. So are some people destined to be bad? Well, it's not that the impressions in the mind are irrelevant, but it's not that they are omnipotent. So some people might have a greater propensity towards, say, anger. Some people might have a stronger propensity towards greed. Some people may have a far stronger impression towards lust. So you could say that some people are more lusty, more greedy, more angry than others. But that doesn't mean that lifelong they have to be like that. So we could say that destiny is like the car which we have been provided. Yesterday I talked about how destiny is like the weather forecast, what kind of weather we are going to get. But today I am developing that metaphor and saying that destiny also determines the kind of car that we get. So some cars they just drive very smoothly. It's such a joy to ride in the cars. But some cars might be old, noisy, polluting, and then sometimes you drive a car, then it's like some cars have power steering. Just pull a little bit and the car just zooms in the other direction. Sometimes you just keep pulling the steering wheel and the car doesn't seem to move only. It's as if the steering wheel is not connected to the wheels at all. So you have to apply a lot of labor for it. So different cars can be of different kinds. So our body mind machine is like the car that we have. So now if somebody has a car that can go very fast and somebody has a car that goes very slowly, that's destiny. But somebody may have a very fast car and they can get into a very big crash. And somebody may have a very slow car, but by driving safely, they can get to the destination. So destiny also determines the kind of car that we have. But destiny doesn't determine how we drive. How we drive is up to us. And if we learn the right driving skills, which also means learning how our particular car is. Now suppose you go to a particular place and you rent a car. Sometimes people hire cabs, but especially in the Western world, renting a car, if you need a car repeatedly, then instead of hiring a cab, just renting a car for a week or something is much cheaper. In fact, now there are self-driving cars. And what happens is, the self-driving cars is you sit in the driver's seat, you just put in the GPS, the car will take you in that direction. But they say that the self-driving car, you have to be watchful. You don't have to hold on the steering wheels. But I have a couple of friends who drove self-driving cars, they said actually that causes more anxiety. Because you're still accountable, ultimately. Because you are in the car, isn't it? If the car goes wrong, imagine if you are in a plane, and just the plane starts, and then they get an announcement. The pilot says, "Today I am working from home." What? We want the pilot there, isn't it? Even if we assume that the plane can be operated by remote, but still, it's not the same thing. So, but if somebody has rented a car, then they know that this is not my car, in the sense that I'm not habituated to using that car. So we have to also understand, okay, how does this car work? How good is the brake? How good is the steering? How good are the fast are the gears? What does the car do well? What does the car not do well? And then that car can be used. And then the person can drive effectively with that car. So similarly for us, we all have to learn what our car is, how our body is, how our mind is. And then, yes, the body and mind that we have, that's what has come to us by destiny. We can't change that. But how we use it is up to us. So nobody is destined, you could say, to act hellishly and go to hell. Yes, we could be destined in such a way that hellish desires will arise within us, hellish propositions will come within us, but we can choose to say no to those propositions. And we can go beyond the impressions in the mind to the pure potential of the soul. And thus, even if we have negative impressions, we can change our destiny by our spirituality. So I'll summarize. I spoke on this topic of are some people destined to be bad? And I started by talking about how destiny, we could say, determines our situations. But some people seem to be wired to behave in a particular way. Like we say, villainous characters. So are they innately bad? So there are two broad theories of human nature. I talked about the left and the right wing. So the right says that we need hierarchies so that work can be done effectively, so that those who know the work well, they can be at the top of the hierarchy and channel the energy of everyone constructively. The left says that anybody who is on top of the hierarchy, they are likely to exploit those who are at the bottom. So therefore, the hierarchy, they say, we should remove it. Now, hierarchy can go towards tyranny, but hierarchy is needed. So this left-right idea, how it applies to our behavior and our morality is that the left says that people are innately good. It's only because they are at the bottom of the hierarchy and somebody has exploited them, somebody has abused them, somebody has kept them deprived, that's why they are bad. So you remove the hierarchy, make everybody equal, and then everybody will be good. So that the right says that people are innately bad and they need to be policed. There had to be rules, there have to be regulations. If this policing is not there, they will go and do wrong. So now the broadly the Christian idea is that we have innate evil within us. We have that original sin within us. So that's an example of this idea that people are innately bad. So I talked about the bhakti understanding is that there are two levels of innateness. That at the most fundamental level of the soul, all of us have the potential for good. But the soul is also covered by the mind. And the mind has a propensity for evil. And so by default, it is not that the potential for good will necessarily manifest. Again, the propensity for vice may also manifest within people. And that's why each one of us has to carefully make sure that in this inner struggle, we do not, we empower the potential for virtue, not the propensity for vice. And then I talked about how every action, it's externally done, but it also internally creates an impression. And that impression comes as a proposition, which again makes us repeat that action. And the stronger the impression, that is more forceful the proposition. And then that's how people may go into addiction. So these impressions that come in the mind, they may come from our past karma. That's like some kids may be just very angry and noisy, even when they are small babies. So Duryodhana, he was evil even before he had any bad association, instead of Shakuni. Also, I talked about how monozygotic twins are also having different behaviors, different personalities, because the genes don't determine alone their behavior at all. Then, of course, there's their upbringing. What kind of surroundings the person had, what kind of guardians they had when they were growing up in their formative years, a lot of impressions are formed by that. And then as they grow up, then there are the there's association that we choose that also shapes how we behave. And so then if we want people to be good, or if we want ourselves to be good, then what is required for that? The one theory is that we need social engineering. And I gave example of my own attempts to help educate slum dwellers. That's why I talked about American history of how the African Americans, the war against poverty actually ended up worsening things. So social engineering alone won't work. We need inner engineering also. So social engineering is where we provide external facilities for people to have a better life. But there are inner obstacles, there are inner demons within us which can ruin the quality of our life. And unless we learn to battle and win against those inner demons, no matter how good external facilities we have, we can't really create a good life for ourselves. So to transform, in some extent, some kind of social external support is good, but most important is that inner engineering. Inner engineering essentially means not just that I have some good side, some good impressions and good bad impressions, and we fight against them. But beyond that, we understand whatever impressions I have, beyond that is the soul, with its potential for virtue, for good. And our spirituality is about drawing out that latent power of the soul. And when we do that, then no matter what kind of mind we have got from our previous lives, no matter what kind of car we have from our previous life, we can still use it to drive expertly and we can get to an auspicious destination. Thank you very much. Hare Krishna. So, any questions or comments? Prabhu, so should Mohan Gaurchandra Prabhu, should we have a break right now? Because we're going to go till 1:30, 1:45 totally in the session. So should we have a break now, or should we go on for maybe half an hour for question answers and then have a break? Is that okay for all of you? That's a decidedly undecided yes. Okay. Stretch yourself for a few minutes and come back. Or? Okay. So, maybe a 10-minute break and then we can come back and we can have questions. Thank you. Hare Krishna.